my name is Ella and I'm the Plants Meow and welcome to my channel. So if you're new to my channel, I'm basically the crazy cat lady and plant lady rolled into one. So I've actually done a more thorough anthurium care video, but while a lot of you did like the scientific approach, some of you wanted a more simplified version of the approach. So what I'm going to do here is basically just tell you straight facts. This is what you're going to do to take care of your anthurium. I'm not going to go into explaining for the most part why you have to do certain things. I'm just going to tell you how to take care of it. So hopefully it's just a very brief and simple video for those of you who are looking for a more just how to. And behind me, I have chosen two models. So this is one of my Anthurium Regale and my Anthurium Pappy. So one of you, please tell me how to pronounce it down below, unless you don't know. Cause it's like papilolaminum. I just can't say it. But I chose these particular plants. I kind of just wanted two plants with me in this video just to kind of have some with me. And these particular ones I have chosen because they have brand new leaves growing in, and I thought it'd be kind of fun to showcase that. As you can tell from the lower leaf on the Regale here, that the new leaf is significantly larger than every other leaf it has had. They were so tiny up until that leaf, so it's pretty nuts. This one is still in the process of growing. She actually just unfurled, but she's been growing very quickly, so I'm assuming that she's gonna be way larger. You can really tell based on the petiole of these plants. If they are just that much thicker than the previous ones, you'll know right away that it's definitely gonna be a larger leaf. And I'm sitting down because this is gonna be a more chilled out video. It's been a long day. I should have put wine in here. I actually just have water, it's not even coffee. I just wanted something to drink. First off, I kind of just want to let you guys know that yes, there's different types of anthuriums. You have more terrestrial anthuriums, you have your more epiphytic anthuriums, but for the most part, the care instructions I have here apply to all of them. I haven't had any issues with my singular method for any of them. They're all just doing fine. So I think I'm doing something right, but not in the beginning though. Like in the beginning, I was just like, I must have only had terrestrial anthuriums in the beginning because, man. Once you get into those epiphytes. So first of all is temperature. You want to keep them between 55 and 90 degrees. Now, I wouldn't suggest going to these extreme points as, like I said, they are extremes. So really, if you can keep them between 65 and 80 degrees, they'll probably be at their peak happiness. So for lighting, anthuriums actually prefer bright but indirect light. So I would never suggest putting them where the sun beams high, especially in those afternoon scorching times. And I would also never suggest to put them in a dark corner because too little light is also detrimental to them as well. You really want to keep them between 50 and 500 foot candles. So I would suggest the lower end only with your very dark and velvety anthuriums if you want that color to kind of continue. But otherwise, don't skip on their light. They're still plants. And if you're not sure how many foot candles you have, there are apps that you can download that measure them with your camera. So it's actually pretty cool. They'll be able to let you know what you have. So with watering, I have a few tips to suggest. One, use room temperature water. Also, keep your pH about between 5 and 6. So what I usually use is I just go out and get distilled water for them. You can also use filtered water, but any kind of hard water will have a really high pH. Now it does depend on your localities, and everyone's tap water is different depending on where you live. So if someone is successfully using tap water to water their plants, I just want you to keep in mind that doesn't mean that it's the same water that you have where you live. Your tap water could be reading much harder than theirs is. And you also don't want to water them with soft water. I have done this out of just pure laziness, and honestly, it's not good because, oh, actually, I have an example. I'll show you one of my old Regale leaves. If you water them with soft water, and I knew I wasn't supposed to, guys. I knew I wasn't. But you know what? Let's just say I was experimenting for you. These like little crispy edges here, that's pretty much the result of that. I haven't had it continue, obviously, since I went back to just using my distilled water. So I definitely regret doing that. I would say even if you are in a pinch, yes, your anthuriums need water, but unless you're prepared for having some kind of markings on your leaves, I would suggest you really do get something filtered. And yeah. So also don't allow your anthuriums to get bone dry. So a lot of our plants, a lot of our aeroids prefer to dry out a lot. I know if I water my philodendrons too early, they get hecka upset with me. So what I like to call it, when you get used to watering your anthurium, you're going to have something called anthurium fingers is what I like to call it. And you're going to want to try to treat your other plants with it. But you got to know that watering hands for anthuriums are much different than every other plant, because anthuriums want to be moist all the time. People say, yes, philodendrons should be kept moist, but not like anthuriums should. They will freak out. With the particular substrate I use in my potting mix, I need to water my anthuriums about twice a week. So I wouldn't suggest ever going longer than 4 days. I've done every 3, 2, 4, but every time I've gone past my fourth day, I certainly regretted it because I've seen the moisture stress on my plants. So definitely remember to keep them watered. They love to be hydrated. And even though they love to be hydrated, they don't like to be standing in water. So make sure after you're done watering them that you do empty their drip trays, as they can certainly rot if they're just left in water. Which I've been asked about LECA a few times for semi-hydro. And yeah, you can grow your anthuriums in that, absolutely. But you have to remember to not fill your reservoir as with as much of the substrate. So what you have to do is fill it to a certain point and let the capillary action of the LECA wick the water up to the roots as it needs it, but don't let it sit soaking in it. I've seen it done successfully, but you have to do it right. To end this little water segment, I do want to let you know, forgetting to water your anthurium is a sure way to kill them. So don't do it. Next, I want to talk about air circulation, which is extremely important to your plant's health. Particularly plants like anthuriums who need really high humidity, air circulation is something that's really going to prevent any kind of fungal and bacterial growth on your plants if you have that air moving around. Also, it's very beneficial for newer leaves because I've seen they certainly grow much larger when you have a good amount of air circulation. When the air is stagnant, I just don't see as much progress with my plant. Right now, I have a fan in my plant room that's just kind of sitting on the ground, and I do have it oscillating around so that air circulation is properly going around the room. But remember not to let the fan sit directly in front of your anthuriums, because if it's there just blowing at them, it's going to blow away all the moisture around it and create a very dry environment, and you don't want to do that for them. So yes, they're sensitive to air, but they also absolutely rely on it to function. So with humidity, typically my plant room stays between about 55 and 60% humidity. That's not extremely high. I do know this. They know this, and they're cool. The reason with that is because if you properly water your anthurium, then humidity is going to be less of an issue for you. If you let your soil substrate dry out and your humidity is low, then you're really creating a terrible situation for your plant. So really, if you remember to water, your plants can be very forgiving when it comes to humidity. But ways you could improve humidity around your plant is our trusty humidifiers. A gravel tray, misting your plant, even just misting the air around it is something that can increase the humidity. Depending where you are, it'll be more beneficial than other areas. If you're in a very dry environment, it's definitely going to soak in that extra moisture and create a better environment around your anthurium. Lastly, we have grouping. So because your anthuriums do transpire, grouping them together allows you to create a microclimate all around them that increases the moisture and humidity in the air. I know my plant room, even without my humidifiers running, is significantly higher in humidity than the rest of my house, just because of all the plants in there. But I would suggest not to have them touching. I never have my leaves touch. I know it probably won't be as easy to do for me in the future as they keep growing, but it's important in case you have any pests or bacterial issues that they kind of just have a little bit of wiggle room so that nothing spreads through contact. Oh, also placing them in a bathroom or a basement where your area is typically higher in humidity can be very beneficial for them as well. So for fertilizer, I use Osmocote 14-14-14, which is the flower and vegetable one, and it is a slow release fertilizer. And I use that because I don't have to worry about my anthuriums for 6 months at a time. It's very easy for me. They like it just fine. There are other options. I know there's a NutriCoat you could also use as well, and I'll put that at the bottom here, what it's called. You can also use a liquid fertilizer treatment, and that I would use weekly, and always use about a fourth or less of the manufacturer's recommended amount. What's great about the liquid is it is released immediately. If you're prepared to water them constantly with this, then go for it. If you think they need nutrition right away, go for that. So on top of just kind of the regular fertilizing, I also monthly use magnesium sulfate. So this is just some additional nutrients that anthuriums themselves do require. And what I usually do is mix about 1 to 2 tablespoons per gallon of water, and I just water my anthuriums regularly with that solution. Magnesium sulfate is also really great because if you happen to over-fertilize your anthurium, particularly with a liquid, you can also use it to leach out excess fertilizer, which is quicker than just kind of draining the pot, which you could do as well. So how you would do that is you just put a teaspoon into a gallon and just pour it in, which is kind of just an additional help in helping you get all those excess nutrients out. So the particular planters I like to use are my black net pots. So I like them because they are extremely airy, and that is so important for your anthurium. The roots absolutely love the oxygen and they grow like weeds. I've already had to repot one of mine because the roots were just out so much that I just couldn't leave it anymore. It was really the best decision to switch to this method, which I want to thank Jay Vanini for that, because I had a few conversations with him about proper anthurium care, and he was very helpful in kind of helping me realize why certain things weren't okay for them. You can also use terracotta. So one of the downfalls of terracotta, it is really difficult to get an anthurium that has glued its roots to the side of the terracotta out. They are thick, bulgy, and stuck. So you'll typically have to break your terracotta pot. I have heard, and don't take my word for this, people have tried soaking their terracotta and are able to get it out that way, but I haven't tried it personally. I don't know how long that takes. To me, that worries me. I would have to see someone else do it because I don't want to risk any of my plants. But again, they shouldn't be left in standing water. So if that works, that's awesome.
So something I would like to mention is that if you really like the terracotta look but don't want to put them in it, you can always place them in a net pot and place that into the terracotta pot as your cash pot.
The least recommended option here is just plastic pots. So with plastic pots, it's not an ideal condition, and you can end up having some root rot because it's just too enclosed, not enough air. But this isn't to say you can't use plastic pots in terms of cash pots. You can always plant in a net pot and put it in a cash pot, as I have done here. And when you're choosing a pot, remember to pick a pot that has some room to grow. A little too big is always better than a little too small. And with repotting, you should really do it every 1 to 2 years or when it is root bound. Anthuriums should not be left root bound for long, so it's important to get them repotted into a new substrate and a new pot as soon as you realize they are root bound. So with soil, there's a few different methods you can use. A lot of people, and I use this for one of my anthuriums at the moment, is sphagnum moss. Sphagnum moss is a completely fine substrate for you to grow them in. As long as you properly fertilize them, then they will grow absolutely fine in that. You just really have to monitor it and make sure it doesn't get compacted over time, as you don't want any of the roots to get suffocated or rotted. So the particular mix I like to use, and you don't have to do this verbatim, so I typically like to use about 7 cups of orchid bark, 1 cup of charcoal, 1 cup of perlite, 1 cup of tree fern, and about 1 to 2 cups of potting soil. And the potting soil that I use is Miracle-Gro Moisture Control Potting Mix. So people are on the fence about using potting soils for anthuriums, and that's because while no, they shouldn't be put in absolutely all soil because that's crazy, I do put a little bit in mine because I don't want to water my anthurium every day. If you have it in a purely airy mixture, then you're going to be likely watering it every day. So I'm actually going to link below a video to Legends of Monstera because he did this absolutely great and I found it so entertaining. I believe it was called Can You Grow Like Your Aeroids in Air? And there's a lot more to that. And it talks about the spectrum of no soil to complete potting soil and really the in-betweens and how much you really have to kind of put maintenance-wise in taking care of your plant based on what you choose on this spectrum. So I thought that was a really great kind of just like simply explained video for people who have a hard time understanding just how potting mixes work and how soil substrates can really affect the watering of your plant. It's a great video to check out, and it was completely charming. You should definitely go see it. And please check out his channel if you haven't already. Now, I do want to mention when it comes to my larger anthuriums, when I make this mix, I typically use about 1 cup every time I make a batch because there's a few batches that end up going into my pot. So I don't want there to be a ton of soil kind of lingering throughout. And I really want them to have a lot more air. Also, while I do use smaller bark pieces in my anthurium mix, especially for my smaller anthuriums, as they get larger, I do start adding medium and larger barks. So I'll typically have the small, medium, and large in my largest anthuriums. My Clarinervium pedateriatum definitely has a lot of large bark pieces in it. I definitely feel comfortable doing that. I've had a larger anthurium where I've just kept it in smaller bark because I've seen it online and it didn't work for it. It wasn't airy enough somehow. So larger bark pieces, definitely recommended in my personal opinion. So usually when I'm done potting them up, I will top them off with my slow release fertilizer and I make sure not to pot them too deeply and I have their just crown kind of sticking out a bit. Also, a lot of people put sphagnum around its stem and I personally think that's a great idea. I don't do it, but I think it's a great idea. And the only reason that I haven't done it is because I've had a bit of a fungus gnat issue. They're pretty much all gone, but yeah, I don't want to bring them back. Also, I haven't had any issues with not having it. So I think the main benefit is to keep it warm and to add a little bit of extra humidity. And I think because I keep on top of watering, I just haven't had a need to do that. So yeah, none of them seem to care that they don't have it. So also, I really want to quickly just show you this pappy leaf. Like, how beautiful is this? It's very, like, it's this very pretty, like, maroon burgundy color. Definitely closer to maroon. But she looks so good, especially, like, compared to her, like, older leaf. The spacing where the sinus is between the lobes is not as large as the newer leaf. The newer leaf looks like a crown. That is a gem. And I'm very, very excited about it. Ah. With pruning, always use sterilized shears or just your finger. So how you're gonna do this is what I usually typically like to do because I find it the cleanest and easiest is really to just push down on the base of your petiole where it connects to the stem and it'll just pop right off. So if you're looking to remove a leaf and you want a clean, smooth cut, just do that. It usually wants to come off. It's not difficult to do. Honestly, I think I've accidentally done that to like a rather healthy leaf. So I know that method is fantastic. But if you're adamant about using the shears or it's just not working when you press down on it, make sure they're sterilized. Either use a hydrogen peroxide solution or some diluted ficin 20. And also don't start like pruning your anthuriums just willy-nilly. They typically need a lot of leaves to survive. A lot of the ones we buy come with one leaf, but you need a few leaves on there to really keep them healthy. Like if your anthurium is really healthy, it would have at least 4 leaves. Now it doesn't mean if it has less that it's unhealthy. It means that's pretty much its kind of peak point. So you'll know that you have a fantastic and happy anthurium if she's kept 4 leaves and she's looking fantastic. But you have to remember each time you cut one off that you're doing it for a reason because she relies on those. So reasons for doing this are going to be any kind of pests, disease, infections, or if you have a lot of leaves and some of them are facing a certain way. And if you've tried staking and that's not exactly working, you may need to prune a few leaves off just to kind of stabilize her and prop her back up in a good position. So sometimes it's really just for the aesthetic. But also if you have an anthurium that's too heavy and she's toppling over, sometimes you gotta do it because you don't want her to snap, because that's also gonna kill your anthurium. And in terms of pests and things, let's talk a little bit about pest control. What I love to use is Dr. Bronner's peppermint castile soap. So I usually mix about 2 tablespoons into a gallon of water, which also translates into a half a tablespoon and 4 cups of water. So I usually put this in a spray bottle, spray down my leaves and my stems very well, and then after about 20 minutes, I rinse that off. This will kill anything on the leaves. Now, sometimes you do have pests that continue to come back, and I will be doing more videos in the future on how to kind of deal with problems that keep coming back. Like right now, I'm going through a thrip issue on a couple of my plants. Gonna admit that, I'm honest. So if you watch my houseplant tour, my Clarinervium and my larger Anthurium magnificum are hiding because they're dealing with that. They're quarantined in the bathroom. I keep spraying them down, they die. I've looked at them very closely with a magnifying device and thrips are gone, right? Well, they come back. So thrips themselves can be a very hard thing to get rid of. They burrow in many, many different places. I'll definitely be making a video about how to kind of get into that. But if you're looking for an immediate solution that will kill anything on the foliage and it's for pests that usually just linger in the foliage, this is going to be fantastic. So one more topic I wanted to really kind of add into this is acclimation. I get a lot of messages about people getting anthuriums and suddenly there's a freak out. So you'll have leaves that are kind of curling and it looks like the color's kind of fading and they're getting crinkly. And really, honestly, anthuriums go through shipping stress. So it's something that really can't be helped. You can do your best. As long as they're in a good substrate, you're giving them proper humidity and making sure they're properly watered. Really, you kind of just got to wait it out. Sometimes you're just going to end up losing the one leaf you have. And hopefully that doesn't kill your plant. So if you source them locally, this shouldn't be an issue, but definitely if you're importing plants, you're gonna have to expect this. And a lot of times you may think you're buying locally, but those people have actually imported them from other places. One of the big problems is if they have imported it from those places and shipped them out the same week to you, that's too much. Ethereum ain't gonna be happy. But if you've done everything else right that I've said in this video and that's happening, you're gonna have to wait it out. I know it's not something you wanna hear, but you've done everything and she'll thank you in the long run. So this Regale and me do thank you for watching this video. I hope you did enjoy this. I feel like I did simplify it a lot. I hope there was enough in here to kind of cover the basics of anthurium care. Did I forget anything? Man, there's something gonna be important. What I got? Light. Temperature, soil, fertilizer. What else is important? I did air. Now that's about it. But really just think about it in this way. Once your anthurium is potted up in a great substrate, you have it in its ideal location. The only thing you have to really water about? What? The only thing you really have to worry about is properly keeping your anthurium watered and making sure the humidity around it is relatively decent. This leaf looks gorgeous on camera. I mean, it looks gorgeous in person too, but dang. Also, when's it gonna stop growing? I can't believe how much larger it is than its previous leaf. Like, this guy? Like, I don't know. I can't even pull it out. His petiole's not long enough. Like, look how big. Compared to his last leaf. Like, these are basically just there for fun. Like, they're nothing now. So I hope you enjoyed this simplified anthurium care video. I will have a lot more anthurium care videos out in the future based on other topics and other care videos other than anthuriums as well, so don't worry. So thank you so much for watching this video. Please leave any feedback for me down below. And please subscribe. I do post every Wednesday. And hit that bell icon if you want to be notified. Thank you so much.